Ah, yes,
the... Oh, yeah.
Okay, I feel so like if you okay, just we're going to go that. In depth about what do you think the ointment is. What brand? Just what is there actual butt ointment, by the way?
Yeah.
Really?
I'm sure there's
Mary,
like a...
tell us about your butt ointment experiences.
What?
I don't have any personal... I don't have any personal experiences.
We just talk about course party, I guess. I don't know. No.
We didn't
plan this out. Okay.
Everyone knows who I am. I mean, I'm in like everything.
Whoa,
on this channel,
okay.
Miss Fails. Miss Popular. Holy.
All right, we are here with three guests. Mary, introduce yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Mari. I'm in another video of his because he forces me to be in all these videos.
Mel, go on. Your turn.
I'm still stuck in his basement from last time. Help me.
Zawada?
I'm, like I said, I'm just here for the free pizza.
So we're just going to talk about Course Party Chapter 1. I have the thing pulled up right now, the game pulled up. So how did you guys get into Course Party? I know Mary, no, I know Mel was through PewDiePie.
It just seemed like one of those series I wanted to avoid for the longest time. And then one of my friends just pushed me a little bit into playing the game. Only he pushed me toward the original game for PC-98, or more specifically a fan-made remake of it called Corpse Party Rebuilt. A year later, I played Corpse Party Zero, and then a year later after that, I played Corpse Party Blood Covered. Going in with the expectations from the original, I got offended horribly.
Oh, Lord. It was also in 2013. It was right before the anime came out, actually. And I was 12 years old, and there was someone in my actual, like, real life who told me about it. She was a little bit older than me, and she asked if I knew what it was, and I actually lied and said that I did know what it was. After I did that, I basically went and pirated the PSP version, and I played Book of Shadows, and really liked it.
Why do you think Morishi deserves to be S tier?
Oh, no. Boy. Coming out with the big questions now, huh?
Already getting into that question, huh?
Okay, well, I was thinking about...
Put it that way, I think I might actually jump on the more chic bandwagon.
You need to bring me on for an episode where he actually shows up for real.
I mean, he's right here.
He's right there.
Look at him. Look at him. Did any of you guys think Satoshi was the main character, by the way? Because I was like, oh, he's the lead, right? Like, we're gonna play as him, and then we don't play as for him for like another two or three chapters. Like, I was so confused.
I can explain this.
I think Satoshi is just the straight man in the narrative. I think that's his character.
Satoshi does a lot more in Rebuilt than he does in this. So I can understand it being him being the protagonist there more than I can understand it here.
I feel like Satoshi is like the character that people could portray themselves on.
I think ultimately Satoshi is a protagonist, but not the protagonist, and that's where the interpretation gets screwed up.
This is cringe, but have you guys ever done the actual Sachiko Ever After ritual?
I've done it three times. I'm not friends with any of those people anymore.
In the original, just telling the ghost story was enough to get you sent to the school. You didn't even have to do a paper charm.
Really?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
What?
It's because the plot of Rebuilt is a lot different than this, and it's because Sachiko is just haunting the school because she's pissed off, not the whole, like, ritualistic spell nonsense. You actually don't have to do anything to get sent there in the Rebuilt universe. Before they do the charm, and Morishige is who takes the picture of them, I just find it interesting that he volunteers to do that. He has an interesting dynamic with everyone else where he's only really friends with Mayu, and the others just kind of think he's there.
Are these guys even friends? Like, are they actually friends? Because I feel like maybe Mayu and Morishige are friends, and then...
A friend group that is connected by individual connections, not necessarily everyone webs together.
Mary, how old were you when you did the Sachiko Ever After?
12.
Trend? Were you scared?
I actually have a story about that. I was, because the timing couldn't have been better, because there was a mini earthquake that happened like 5 minutes after we did it.
Oh my god, are you serious?
No way.
It was like a really mini earthquake, and I was, my, I don't know. It was wild, I think.
Corpse Party gameplay, it's an RPG Maker game. I thought it was well done, but we're here in this segment where you go to this classroom and it's the newspaper room. I hated this segment. I hated it because I just want to explain my thought process when I first played this, because I was trying to be smart, you know? I was like, oh, I don't want any of the characters to die, because I just thought in my head, and whatever you do, you have to read the newspaper. And I thought that was stupid.
Looking from a game design perspective, the way it is, it's stupid. I didn't even come across this room until after I had gotten that horrible, horrible, horrible wrong ending later on in the chapter. And so I was at a loss on what I could possibly be doing wrong, because every time you get the second wrong end in this chapter, you're sent back to the infirmary event. And so you don't know what you could possibly be doing wrong. The issue was not in that event. The newspaper room, in this case, should have just been a wrong end. Surviving the infirmary event should have led to the true ending no matter what.
I don't understand what you guys are talking about. I've come across this room and looked at the newspaper every single time I've played, just instinctively. Like, the first time I ever played it, I found that room no problem.
No, and well,
I,
yeah,
I,
it's like,
I, of course, looked at it, because, like, you know, it says don't.
Look, I found the room, and then it's like, oh, whatever you do, don't look at the newspaper. And I was like, okay.
Man, I think you guys are too trusting.
It took me like, I think chapter one took me like 6 hours. I had to Google it. I was like, I don't like Googling the answers to things. I usually get Mel to do that for
Same.
Me.
Yeah.
But I had to Google it. I'd be like, okay, how the fuck do you beat this game? It might be a turnoff to a lot of players. It definitely was for me.
Oh yeah, actually I do have one comment on this scene. If you didn't inspect the stall Seiko goes in before the event, Seiko tries to shake hands with Naomi without washing her hands, and it gets called out on that, and that's funny.
Did you tell me that during the stream?
No, someone else did, and I tested it and learned that it was the case.
Actually, let's take an intermission, because I gotta bust the yuca right now, so.
We can finally reveal that we're all being held against our will to make these videos, and
I'm still stuck in his basement, by the way. Give me food. I feel like Book of Shadows is just pretty much made to polish up on the details that they missed out on within the original game.
It's just blood covered 1.5.
Corpsi is still around, by the way.
Yeah, I'm here.
It's Mayu.
Hello, Mayu. Hello.
Hello, Mayu.
I love the idea of multiple closed spaces on top of each other, because it's not time travel, but there is a sense of time manipulation where it's like, oh, we see Mayu here, but they're in the past, and then we see who it is later. And I love that. Mary, you pointed out in extra chapter 14 or 13
of the 3DS version, by the way.
Yes. Okawa, technically, Yoshiki already observes Okawa's body, and then he meets him later. And I thought, like, oh, that's closed spaces. That's how it works. And I just love the idea of, like, time, you know, manipulation.
Is it bad that the first time I played this version of Corpse Party was on a fucking iPod Touch?
No. Did it run well?
I mean, it really started to lag and crash on chapter 3 with Satoshi, I believe it was.
I was going to say, I would like to apologize to all the viewers that we don't have, like, much to talk about regarding this chapter. Because, like, it's not a lot that happens. I really hated this part from a gameplay standpoint. I died, like, 7 times before I finally got it.
I always had the most trouble when you reach the door and realize you have to get the lighter fluid, I believe it was. Yeah, and then you have to run back, and there's so many holes in the ground, and that thing is just there.
Thankfully, once you know where everything is and what needs to be done, that does make it easier on repeat playthroughs.
It's this part where Naomi just snap. Well, it's the darkening, right?
Yes, she's darkened here.
Yes, so I didn't know. Well, you don't find out about darkening until chapter 2, what the spirit tells you. And I just thought, like, holy shit, like, oh my god, this character is, like, you know, deep. Like, she has baggage, you know? And it turns out it's just darkening.
Baggage, huh?
Yeah.
Which I think, I don't know if that deteriorates the character for me.
I think the darkening is a really underrated concept in Corpse Party. I think everyone tends to either overlook it or interpret it incorrectly, I think. Or not incorrectly, but just interpret it in a way that doesn't make sense, to me at least. There's nothing scarier to me than being overtaken by something you can't see, but you can feel that something's wrong with you.
Yeah, I get that. I do feel like it was underrealized in this game, but I can't speak for the whole official series how the darkening was used, since, like I said, I haven't played Book of Shadows. In Blood Covered specifically, it was underutilized and honestly felt like a cop-out in the case of Naomi killing Seiko in some ways.
Yeah, I feel like the darkening as is, you know, pretty terrifying. It's like a pretty scary concept when you like think about being in their shoes and like, for example, watching, I don't know, a friend of yours just like slowly like lose themselves to this, like, you know, I'm not sure if it's insanity, but it slowly changes them, right?
Like Mary said, darkening has a bad rap, because for me, I think it's scarier that your friends just start going crazy because the stress gets to them and they're like, my life is over, like this is where I die, and they start going crazy. And I'm pretty sure the darkening enhances that. But I think it would be scarier if the darkening wasn't a thing.
My favorite thing about the darkening is how it works in relation to different characters, because it affects different characters differently. Like, for example, Kazami doesn't actually get darkened.
Yeah, he's That's just how he is. Murdering
he's just like that.
Just, yeah.
That, or he gets darkened, but it's in a different way where it's not much different than how he already was. And in the case of Naomi, she gets the anger and resentment she had held. Just find it interesting that the darkening works, how the darkening works in relation to different characters, because it affects everyone differently. And that's why I think it's an underutilized and underrated thing in the Corpse Party universe.
So follow the voice. What happens if you put no? The game just stops, right? I understand it's an RPG Maker game. Come on. Like, they have to have these little things, but I don't know. I just wanted to point it out. I don't really have a problem with it because, I mean, I don't make games, dude. What do you think about these segments where, like, it's pretty much like they give you an option, but it's a false option? What do you think about
it? Please write us a thesis really like on this.
For here, it works for atmosphere. Actually, the original game had a lot of cases where there was a yes or no prompt you could choose between, and in places that just didn't really make sense to have a prompt, and they just had basically the same effect, maybe some different dialogue, or even in a lot of cases the same dialogue. It was actually worse in the original than in Blood Covered handles those matters more in a make sense manner. That was not English at all, but I think I still got my point across.
For chapter 5, you know, when Yuka has the option like, oh, stay silent or talk, for me it makes sense because you're portraying yourself as Yuka, like, what would you do? But like these little segments, I don't know why we're talking about this still. Let's move on. Mary, you got anything?
Yeah, I was just gonna say, I really like the way that this game and Book of Shadows does it, because the way both games do it is they give you choices and you don't know which choices will matter and which ones won't.
Yeah, that's a good one.
I think that's a really smart gameplay idea, because then you don't know if this choice is going to lead to something horrible or if it's just going to be nothing. You have to like think about it and second guess yourself, and it just kind of, it adds to the experience, I think.
Yeah, and then in Book of Shadows, you could like quick save as well. But I think once you know, like, you already know, so.
Yeah, it's
once you know, you already know.
It's not good for replayability, but it's good the first time you play.
Mel, you don't understand. Until you understand, you're not going to understand.
How's all right, it hanging?
First, oh, okay, so there's no P here. We're talking about the P. We're not talking about the dead corpse. We're talking about the P. There is no P.
Because she's not dead yet.
They're censoring this for American audiences.
How could they?
Oh, how shows could up they?
Later. Unbelievable.
It shows up later.
Does it?
Jeez. Yeah.
It's a known fact that dead bodies expel all of those bodily functions once they are dead. So, of course, I don't know why I'm bothering to defend Ch.1's fetish.
What if it was like poo?
Gangster?
That'd be funny.
No, that wouldn't be funny. Also, I think I'll have to eat my own foot. I think I was thinking of the 3DS version, because the 3DS version has it go on for a little longer.
I want to take another moment here. When Naomi is flipping the bucket, somehow she gets the gross stuff, whatever is in the bucket, all over her skirt and legs and possibly even hands. That's not how physics works. Did she point the bucket toward
herself?
There
was a hole in the bottom. There was a hole in the bottom. So when she picked it up, then whoops.
Okay, that would be a better that would be a better explanation. But I don't think that was actually explained in the.
No, it is because when you do the bucket, it says that the bottom is rusted through.
Oh, I guess I missed that part. So
I mean, it's an RPG Maker game. Like, come on.
Yeah, it's an RPG Maker game.
Honestly, suspension of disbelief, like. I think this Copa, game earns it.
For Copa, you really got to suspend your disbelief for a lot of things. Like, for example, like not with all like the wrong ends and everything, that amount of blood will not come out of anyone. People don't explode like that when they're thrown against walls and stuff. So it's like, you know, you just gotta like just be in the anime world for a second.
Welcome to Game Theory. Today we're going to be launching a human being 50 miles per hour towards that wall.
I can suspend my disbelief that far. It's when it goes into certain characters acting the way they're doing. I'm not just talking about darkening stuff, but like Yuka being Yuka in certain cases. Like,
oh god.
Just pee in the corner, please.
Yes!
That was just Cohen being weird.
This is two people who have never really experienced anything like this, and then making it through a portion of the experience and losing someone they knew for like a large portion of their life.
Before I want to go way back like 20 minutes, you know, the newspaper scene, and she loses her little, you know, her little paper.
Yep.
That
it's my favorite topic.
So she loses her little paper, and it's great foreshadowing, like, you lost your paper, like, you're guaranteed to like die. Yeah. You're guaranteed to die. And I love that. I loved the, because it came back like four chapters later, it came back, and you're just like, oh wow, like, okay, cool.
I really like that concept of the scrap being tied to your life, and if you lose it, then that's it.
Yeah, because it, you know? What's the ritual? The ritual is to be friends forever. As long as you carry that piece of scrap paper, you will always be bound to your friends.
Blades later, you don't understand.
Or in this case, to hell.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, you could catch Mary on Twitter at MaryCore with two I's. You could catch Mel here on the show right now. Say hello.
Hi.
And in the link, I guess.
You can catch me, Zwataketa, on Twitter at Zwataketa. That's Zwataketa. And you can also catch me on the collab channel I run with me and my friends called The Melting Pot Commentaries here on YouTube. Oh, and I'm working on a game, a Corpse Party fan game, Corpse Party Rebirth. And more details will come eventually.
I think we're good, right? Oh, actually, I just got a message from Hideo Kojima.
Oh, God, here
we
go.
Oh, no. Not this
He said
again.
To delete my YouTube channel because it's infringing on copyright.
No!
Here, I'll do it for you.